Brethren, beloved, Church, Valley View Church of the Nazarene, is very good to see everyone here. As you know, I'm not the pastor. I'm not Jill or Gavin, either one. I'm Mark Hayworth, just another member of the church here. But it's always good on Sunday to see the beloved in our church, isn't it? People that love each other, appreciate each other. And let me remind you that we are the beloved of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we have two announcements. I think I'll just try to do this from memory. So we're taking up an offering today for the World Radio Association, Nazarene World Radio, which in Sunday school we learned about. You know, it started in 1944, and we are having radio programs into Muslim countries, just all over the world. It's just a wonderful, wonderful organization. And then I want to remind you on, I believe it is June 19th, it's going to be in a couple of weeks, we're going to have a work day at 9 a.m. So just start putting that on your calendar. I know that summer is a hard time to make appointments in that far in the future, but we are going to have a work day on June 19th at 9 a.m. And with that said, I'm going to give it to Stephen.
Let's stand and worship.
To break on through. I wanna go and go on and move and move. I wanna love who you love. Watch it break on through. I wanna go and go on and move and move. I wanna love who you love. Watch it break on through. can fill me. Man's empty praise treasures of faith are never enough. When you came along, put me back together. Is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Lord, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you. The God of the mountain is the God of the valley. And there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Burden for too long on my created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. Run to the Father, fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again. And again and again and again. Oh, oh, oh. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption.
Father, we thank you for the love and grace that you give us each day. Father, we all have problems. We all have things that we're thinking about that we're going to try to solve this next week. We know we can't solve them without you, Lord. Lord, I just lift up the congregation here and pray your blessing upon them. Lord, we ask that our hearts be open to David's sermon today. Let your grace come down. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Kids, you are dismissed to go to the bags are over here. Okay, kids, if you're here, your bags are over here on the wall. All right. Come on up.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, brother. Well, good morning. It's been just a minute since I've seen most of y'all. Today is 9 months since we've been out of the sanctuary, so Davina and I both feel very blessed that we could be with you all today. I hope that I prepared something encouraging today for us. I shouldn't be nervous, but I am. I don't know why, but I am. I'm amongst those who love me. I know I am, so I shouldn't be nervous. I have this list this morning that I want to read to us first thing. And it's God's broken soldiers. And I think it's relevant because there's not a one of us that's not broken. Not any of us that aren't broken. And this list is all people who God used. So even in our brokenness, we're available to God. God will use us. The first one is Abraham. Said he was old. Elijah, he was suicidal. Joseph was abusive. Job went bankrupt. Moses, he had a speech problem. I can relate to that. Gideon was afraid. Samson was a womanizer. Rahab was a prostitute. The Samaritan woman was divorced. Noah was a drunk. Jeremiah was young. Jacob was a cheater. David was a murderer. Jonah ran from God. Naomi was a widow. Peter denied Christ 3 times. Martha, she worried about everything. Zacchaeus was small and money hungry, and the disciples, well, they fell asleep while praying. Paul, a Pharisee who persecuted Christians before becoming one. I'm sure none of those names or things hit any of y'all anywhere, but it's just a reminder that God has purposes for all of us. I want to remind us all that in God, there is no waste. Never, ever, ever, ever is there any waste. He will take the worst situation and turn it into something good. I'm a testimony to that. Most of us are. This morning, we're going to read out of the book of Daniel. It's a great story. We're going to be in chapter 1 first, and then we're going to go over to chapter 6. But we need to talk a little bit. I like to talk a little bit about the subject that I'm going to preach on. And this morning I want to talk about Daniel. And Daniel, when he was a young man, got caught up in being an exile. Now, exile is someone who is taken from the place where they've been, and they're taken to a place, and they have freedom, but yet they can't leave. Does that sound familiar to y'all? We've kind of been in exile ourselves, haven't we? The whole year of 2020... we were in exile. We weren't sent away from our home, sent away from the land that we knew, but we were sent to our homes and told to stay. We couldn't come to church and worship, which is unimaginable that we couldn't come to church and worship. Many of us couldn't go to church. Many of us couldn't go to work. We couldn't go to school. There's many things that we couldn't do. So we can kind of relate to some of what Daniel is going through. Now, I want to talk just a minute about what led up to the exile. Daniel's just a young boy at this point. He's just 14 years old. He's not responsible for what has happened for the exile. No, that goes back to King Solomon. Actually, King David, but King Solomon was the beginning of the problem. King Solomon was the greatest king that there ever was. He had more riches of any king before him and any king after him. But because of his disobedience, because he wasn't paying attention to the Lord, there were some things the Lord told him not to do that he simply couldn't follow, which was his lust for women. Because of that, he worshiped gods. He worshiped false gods, and that angered the Lord. And the Lord told him, I will separate this kingdom, and I will destroy it. Not during your time, but after you're gone, I will destroy it. So sure enough, Solomon dies. His son takes over. The kingdom is separated at that point. Well, the disobedience continues. They're worshiping false gods. They're not doing the things. They're not following the law of Moses. They're not coming to the temple and doing the things they're supposed to do. So before long, the words of the Lord come true. The Babylonians are sent, and they level the place. Now, there's something about Daniel here that I found amazing. He has something that we could only dream of. He's a young boy. He's 14. During his lifetime, he got to see the temple. He got to see Solomon's temple. He got to live where God resided. For us, we have the Holy Spirit, but we have to believe in what we can't see. Daniel was able to believe in what he's seen. He was there when he was a little boy. He got to see where God himself resided. He was in the land that the Lord, his place. Unfortunately, the last thing he probably remembers from that country is seeing it in rubble, total ruins. But Daniel has something I would like to say I wish I had. I wish I could walk through the temple and see the walls lined with gold and the wood, the wonderful wood scrollings and everything, and the place where God himself resided. Wouldn't that be something? That would be awesome. Of course, God has given us a gift that is much greater than that. We're going to start here in Daniel chapter 1. I'll try to get some of these names right. They kind of get my tongue tied a little bit, but I'll try to get them right as we go through it. It says, in the third year of the reign of King Jehoiakim of Judah, King Neb, I'm going to call him King Neb because I have a hard time saying Nebuchadnezzar, but King Neb of Babylon came to Jerusalem and besieged it. The Lord let King Jehoiakim of Judah fall into his power, as well as some of the vessels of the house of God. These he brought to the land of Shinar and placed the vessels in the treasury of his gods. Then he commanded his palace masters, Ashpenaz, to bring some of the Israelites of the royal family and nobility, young men without physical defect and handsome, versed in every branch of wisdom, endowed with knowledge and insight, and competent to serve in the king's palace. And they were taught literature and language of the Chaldeans. Now, why would he want to do that? He's a pretty smart king. Now, there was a prophet that told people after they were sent there to go and plant crops and marry amongst yourselves and prosper because you're going to be here a while. About 7 generations, about 70 years is how long they would be there. So the king, like I said, was very intelligent. He thought, well, I need to get some of these people, these exiles, into my chambers and with us so they will be able to relate to those people, so they will have a voice in the kingdom. So he's done that. He said, the king assigned to them daily portions of royal rations of food and wine. They were to be educated for 3 years. So at the end of the time, they could be stationed in the king's court. Among them were Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah from the 2 tribe of Judah. The palace master gave them other names. Daniel was called Belshazzar. Hannah was called Shadrach. Meshach was called Meshach. And Azraza was called Abednego. I'm really surprised I got that right. I have problems with that for some reason. But Daniel resolved that he would not defile himself with royal rations of food and wine. So he asked the palace master to allow him not to be defiled. Now, this is the first sign in the scripture that shows that God is with him. It says, now God allowed Daniel to receive favor and compassion from the palace master. Now, there's something different about Daniel. Something different we need to talk about right quick before we go any further. Daniel's parents, I take my hat off to them, because they were obedient. They taught Daniel from the time he was little how he needed to live, how he needed to worship the Lord, how he needed to be close to the Lord, how he needed to follow the book of Moses, which was not a book at the time. You just had to learn it. How he needed to follow the Ten Commandments and also food that you were to eat. So it says, now God allowed Daniel to receive favor. So this is the first time in the text that we see that God is with him. Even though he's been exiled into a place far away from his home, God is still with him. Now, why is that? Because he's obedient to God. That's the reason why. It says, the palace master said to Daniel, hey, I'm afraid of the Lord, the king, that he's appointed your food and drink. And if he should see that you're in poor condition, the rest of them, then it could be my head. The king doesn't want that. Neither does the palace master. He don't want to have that problem. Then Daniel asked the guard whom the palace master had appointed over Daniel and the other three. He said, please just test your service for 10 days. Let us be given vegetables and to eat and water to drink. And then you can compare our appearance with the young men who eat the royal rations and deal with your servants accordingly. Now, I like that word servant. Daniel is aware of who he is and what his place is. He's aware that he is a servant. That's something we need to look at. So he agreed with the proposal and tested them for 10 days. And at the end of the 10 days, it was observed that they appeared better and fatter than all the young men who had been eating the royal rations. So the guard continued to withdraw the royal rations of wine that they were to drink and gave them vegetables. To these four young men, God gave knowledge and skill in every aspect of literature and wisdom. Daniel also had insight to visions and dreams. Remember what I was talking about here a minute ago? Even people, when they're broken, God continues to use them. Daniel is broken. He's been swapped up, taken to a different place. He's young. He's just 14 years old. And he's been put into the king's court in a position of power. We're going to see that he has power and things. But you see here where because he is obedient, God has given him knowledge and skill. Remember, there's no waste with God. He's going to take something unusable, like a 14-year-old boy, and give him knowledge and skills that you can't even imagine. It says at the end of the time, the king had set for them to be brought in, and the palace master brought them into the presence of King Neb. And the king spoke with them, and among them, no one was found to compare with Daniel and the three. And so they were to be stationed in the king's court in every manner of wisdom concerning which the king inquired them to have 10 times better knowledge than anybody else in the whole kingdom. 10 times. And Daniel continued there until the first king of Cyrus. So we're seeing already, he's just been there. He's just a boy, and he's been through the training. But we see that there's already something different about Daniel. Now I want to talk about this for a minute. don't want to get too off far here. I want to ask all of us. We're all children of God. Do people see God in us? Do people see God in us? Who we are? Can people tell that we're children of God? For Daniel, there was proof in the pudding, wasn't there? They could tell there was something different about Daniel because where he had come from, but it wasn't just because where he'd come from, it was because who he was. He was obedient to God. He was a child of God. And so people could see a difference in him. They knew something was different. I hope for all of us that we strive to walk close with God, to listen to God, worship him. And I believe, I honestly believe, that if that is happening, that people know who we are without ever saying a word. Very good stuff. So from here, we're going to go to chapter 6. Now, along the way to chapter 6, we're going to see that Daniel, there was a king, King Neb. He had some dreams, and Daniel was able to sort those out for him. He also, another king, because of his disobedience, was doing things he shouldn't have been doing. One time, seeing this hand, this strange-looking hand writing on the wall, scared them to death. They went and found everybody, tried to find everybody in that region to figure out what was going on. So they went and found Daniel, and he told them what was going on, and let's just say they weren't pleased with what he had to say. The other three also had interesting things happen with him. They were also, I want to talk about them for a minute, they were also obedient to God and followers of God. And it came about that they were serving under one of the kings. At this point, Daniel is on his fourth king. But they were serving under one of the kings, and a false god had been made, and they were told that they had to worship that god, and they wouldn't do it, so they were thrown into the fire. They were thrown into the fire. They looked in and seen the fire had not consumed them. And there weren't just three of them, but there were four of them. The angel of the Lord was in there with them. But they were brought out of the fire. Not even a hair was singed. The Lord was with them. They're children of God. So that brings us to chapter 6. This is kind of where the sermon is this morning. And I want to say a couple of things. At this point, like I mentioned, Daniel has served under four kings. He's 80 years old at this point. He's been away from home a long time. He's been away from home a long, long time. Remember in the first covenant, they were told certain things they had to do. But one of the things that they had to do was they were supposed to go to Jerusalem to pray. They were supposed to go to the temple to pray. They were supposed to make their offerings there, their sin offerings. Daniel hadn't been able to do that for a long time. He's made the best of it. He's been obedient. He's been walking with the Lord, praying, doing what he should do. But can you imagine after 60 years, the last thing that he's seen in his head? I hope that the last thing that he's seen as he was leaving Jerusalem isn't how he remembered Jerusalem. The last thing that he's seen when he was leaving Jerusalem was the place being in rubble and on fire. But I really hope that when his earlier years that he remembers Jerusalem at its greatest. I think most of us have examples of that. When I was young, my parents lived out on a farm out east of Tulia. And it was a great place. It was a section of land. It was an old farmhouse. An old, I think they used it for milking and what have you. Anyway, it was a big barn, a couple of barns, and the land seemed like it went on forever. Great place. Now, the reason why I'm saying that is because I have that picture in my mind of how it was when I was a kid. My sister and I got to go to that place a couple of years ago, and all that's left is a well house. You would never know. You would never know that there was a big old farmhouse there that raised four boys and a daughter. You'd never know that. So thank goodness that we can remember things like that. I hope Daniel remembered the way things were when he was a boy, not how it looked when they were taking him away from there. So remember now, he's 80 years old. Chapter 6, verse 1. It said, it pleased King Darius to set the kingdom over 120 satraps. Now, a satrap is a governor, is what a satrap is, throughout the whole kingdom, and over three presidents, including Daniel, to these satraps gave account to the king that might suffer no loss. Soon Daniel distinguished himself above all other presidents and satraps because he had an excellent spirit that was in him. And the king planned to appoint him over the whole kingdom. What? We have an exile? Basically a prisoner that the king is going to put over the whole country? Well, you know that didn't make some people happy. You know, there's some people that had hate and jealousy in their hearts that were going to do everything they could to keep that from happening. So the presidents and the satraps tried to find grounds for complaint against Daniel in connection with the kingdom, but they could find no grounds for complaint or any corruption. Any corruption could be found in him. None. That's amazing. You have a man that has nothing to do with that country. He has no interest in that country. But there's something different about him that we keep talking about. He's a child of God. He's a child of God. And if we're children of God, then God is in control of us. And no matter what we're doing, no matter what it is, we're supposed to be honest and have integrity about what we're doing because we're children of God. So the men said, I love this part, we shall not find any ground or complaint against Daniel unless we find it in connection with the law of his God. They got him, didn't they? Right under the belt. They finally found a place that they could get Daniel. The law of his God. Find it in connection with the law of his God. So the presidents and the governors conspired and came to the king and said, O King Darius, live forever! All the presidents of the kingdom, the prefects and the satraps, the counselors and the governors, are agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce a law that whoever prays to anyone, divine or human, for 30 days except to you, O king, shall be thrown into the den of lions. Now the king established the law and signed the document so that it cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked. Therefore, the king signed it, and the law became in effect. The king's been had. He just doesn't know it yet. So this next part really, it really stabs me pretty hard. Although Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he continued to go to his house, which he had windows in the upper room towards Jerusalem. It said he'd get down on his knees three times a day and pray to his God and praise him, just as he had done previously. Now I picture first Daniel hearing what the law that had been passed. Second, Daniel saying, I'm not turning my back on you, God. I'm not changing what I've been doing. But the part that really got me was that he's 80 years old, and he's been going upstairs to his house. And let's just say that the window that he's praying out of faces the east. Maybe that's probably the direction that he came when they took him out of Jerusalem. That's probably the direction that he came to Babylon. So for over 70 years, this man has been going and looking out this window that's facing the east and praying to his God. Praying to his God. Hopefully he doesn't remember, like I said, how it looked when he left. Hopefully he remembers of Jerusalem in its splendor. And as he was a boy, his parents told him, these are the things you need to do, and you need to go to the temple and praise the Lord and follow what he tells you and do what the Lord tells you to do. Follow the book of Moses, obey the Ten Commandments, be obedient to God. So Daniel has done that his whole life. And now it looks kind of grim, doesn't it? So the conspirators came naturally, and they found Daniel seeking mercy before God. Daniel praying, asking God to do something. He didn't know what. He knew where he's headed. Daniel had no idea how God could fix it, but we know through God he can do anything that he chooses to do. But it's hard for us sometimes to grab a hold of that and really understand that. But he's praying for mercy. It says, then they approached the king and said, concerning the law, O king, did you not sign a law that anyone who prays to anyone, divine or human, within 30 days, except you, O king, shall be thrown into the den of the lions? And the king answered, the thing stands. I did. I passed it. The thing stands, and according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked, it cannot be changed. So then they respond to the king, and they say, Daniel, one of your exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, O king, or the law that you have signed. And he's telling us that he prays three times a day. Well, at this point, the king knows he's been had, doesn't he? I bet it all came real, real, real clear to him at that point what had happened. When the king heard of the charge, he was very much distressed. He was determined to save Daniel. Until the sun went down, he made every effort to rescue him. Then the conspirators came to the king and said, O king, the law of the Medes and the Persians that have no entity or ordinance that the king established can be changed. In other words, you can't do a thing. You have to follow through with what the law say, O king. So the king gave the commandment, and Daniel was brought. And I hate this word. Remember, he's 80 years old. Threw him into the den of the lions. And the king said, may your God, who you serve faithfully, deliver you. I love that part. The king has seen who Daniel is. There is no mistaking that he's a child of God. He's been with Daniel a long time. Daniel's been there a long time. There is no mistaking. Daniel has made it perfectly clear that he's a child of God. And he worships the Lord, and he follows the Lord's ordinances. Just from that statement, we can tell. And so it says, a stone was brought and laid at the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet, and with the signets of his Lord, so that nothing might be changed concerning Daniel. Now, I love this part right here. It says, then the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting. No food was brought to him, and sleep fled from him. The king loved Daniel. He cared for him. And he'd seen the light now that he had really been set up. He had been taken. And that he was fixing to lose something very, very special to him. But things are fixing to change. Then at break of day, the king got up and hurried to the den of lions. And when he came near the den, he cried out anxiously, "Oh, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, who you faithfully serve, been able to deliver you from the lions?" Here we go. Daniel said to the king, "Live forever. My God has sent his angel and shut the mouths of the lions so they would not hurt me." Now, to me, I see something different here just besides that. You can shut the mouth of a lion. He's still very capable of killing you. They weigh 200-300 pounds. Their feet are that big with claws like knives. Oh, no. God done much more than just close the mouth. I think he turned the lions to lambs. And how I look at things is, they may have thrilled Daniel into that den, but when he landed on his knees, and he stood up, and he wiped the dirt off of him, and he looked over at the lions, and they're standing there, and they look at him like, "What's up? What you up to, Daniel? We're going to hang out with you for a while." I suppose it was daylight, so it got dark. The lions laid down. Daniel had him a nice little bed that evening, right in the middle of the lions. Yeah, the Lord knew who Daniel was. The Lord was protecting Daniel and taking care of Daniel, much like he does us. Amen? Amen to that? Amen. So it says, "I was found blameless before him and also before you, O king, because I have done no wrong." The king was exceedingly glad and commanded that Daniel be taken out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no kind of harm was found on him because he had, here's the key, we need to be listening. He had trusted God. He had trusted God. Do we trust God? Do we really trust God? Sometimes it's hard. Sometimes it's really hard when we have loved ones that are sick, or that we lose loved ones from one thing or another. And we're like, "God, what are you doing? What do you remember even who I am?" Do we trust in God? He always has a plan for us that is so much better than we can even imagine. So did Daniel trust God? Yes, Daniel trusted God. So we have to stop and think about a young boy, 14 years old, who has been taken away from everything he knew. And then he's brought to a country, and then I didn't mention this, but then separated from his family. He got to that country. He didn't even have his family anymore. He could have been killed at that point. So what did he have? He had to trust in God. God was all he had, which God was sufficient, wasn't he? He was sufficient. He gave him everything he possibly needed. So trusting in God, that pretty much says it all. The scripture, when I begin to read it, God kind of opened things up to me. I couldn't believe that how much the Lord is talking and telling us how much to trust him and to obey him and to follow him and believe in him. It says no harm was found on him because he had trusted in his God. Now the king gave the command, and I hate this part of it. The king gave the command, and those who had accused Daniel were brought in, and here's that word again, thrown into the den of lions. Them, their children, and their wives. Before they reached the bottom of the den, the lions overpowered them and broke all their bones into pieces. What a horrific sight. What a horrific thing to even think about. Then the king wrote to all the people, and we need to listen to this. The king wrote to all the peoples and nations of every nation, of every language, throughout the whole world. Throughout the whole world. And now remember, he's not a worshiper of our God. He's not. Something's fixing to change about him. It says, may you be abundant and prosper. I make a decree that in all my royal dominion that people should tremble before the God of Daniel. Now, I love this. He makes that statement, but then the very next statement, he says, for he is the living God. It sounds like he may have found God, doesn't it? He may have accepted God right then. That may have been all that, which that'd be all the testimony I would need. I don't know about you. That would be all I would need. And it says that his kingdom shall never be destroyed, and his dominion has no end. He delivers and rescues. Amen? He delivers and rescues. His works and signs and wonders in heaven and on earth. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. And it said, for he has saved Daniel from the power of the lions. I mentioned something at the beginning of this, that Daniel had something that we don't have, and we have something that Daniel didn't have. Daniel seen the place where God stayed, a home where, that was built for God. He lived in the place where God at the time in the first covenant said, that's where we're supposed to go and worship. That's a really neat thing to think about, isn't it? But we have something that is much stronger than that. But we have to believe in what we can't see. But we've received the Holy Spirit. We have received the Holy Spirit. God is in us. We don't have to go and look at Jerusalem. Jerusalem is in us. Jesus is in us. We have something much greater than what Daniel had. But it's still kind of neat to think about how Daniel, what he got to think about when he was a boy. So in looking at the message this morning, I see obedience over all of it. Trusting, walking with God. People seeing God in us. I see obedience in all of that. Now, this message may not be for all of us, but if there's one person in here today or on Facebook that has doubt about who God is and what he is, how much he loves us, I want to reiterate that God sent Jesus, or Jesus came. He walked upon the earth. He had 12 misfits that followed him called disciples. They were disciples because they were students. Jesus was teaching them about some things because Jesus had a job to do and he was going to leave them to finish up his work. So Jesus went to the cross, the ultimate one time, does it all, sacrifice for us, paid the price for us. After the third day, he rose, resurrection from the grave. And then after that, he went to heaven, and then he done what we're waiting for. Yeah, he sent the helper. He sent what we need. He sent the Holy Spirit to us. So God resides in us. Now we have to be obedient. That's one thing we do have to do. That is one requirement that we are to do. The price has been paid. Our sins are forgiven. We've all been washed clean. But we can't stay that way. We can't stay clean unless we're obedient to God and repent. This morning, in closing, I want to ask the guys to come. As they're coming, I wanted to speak to you all on Facebook this morning. I'm also going to ask for an altar call this morning. But for those of you that are on Facebook, if you don't know, if you're not sure, if you're on the fence about if God loves you or not, he does. If you're somewhere you think, well, I'm like Daniel, I don't have a place to pray. God is not about where we pray. He just wants us to pray. So if you're at home, wherever you're at, you find a place in your home to pray. My wife and I, our living room couch seems to be the place. It works well. It's comfortable. Not that we need to be comfortable praying to the Lord, but that seems to be a good place. So wherever you are, come and pray. Those of you who are with us in the congregation this morning, if you'd like to come to the altar, I'm going to find my place down here and pray. We thank you. Thank you.
your friend. Your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. You're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride, free of all her guilt, rid of
of us that there's no waste with you, Lord, that you take it all and use it. Father, I'm so grateful for that. Because many of us, if we didn't have that promise, we'd be simply hopeless. So, Father, we thank you for that. Lord, this morning I want to pray for Jerusalem first. This morning, Father, I pray that your blessings will fall on that country. Lord, I pray that you will wake those people up over there. Another, remind them of your words. Remind them of who you are and what you are and what that place over there is. Father, it's so important. Lord, we also want to pray for those who are at family camp today, Lord. Father, I pray that you move in that place today, Lord, and that many people will come to you, young and old, that it is very simply a life-changing event, that when they leave that place, they will never forget family camp of 2021. Lord, that will be a turning point in their lives. Father, also pray for that here in the sanctuary today, that today, this very day, that today is a turning point for someone. Father God,
whether on Facebook or in this room today, that today is a turning point for them. No more trying to go on their own. No more of trying to do things on their own. That they surrender to you, Lord. That they give it all to you, Lord. Father, it's such a wonderful thing to do. So, Father, I pray that they find you today. Lord, we also want to pray for this lady, her name Mary Shipler, this morning. She's a friend of ours that she's an elderly lady that's lost her balance and has fallen and ended up in the hospital, landed on her head, caused some damage. Father, I pray you'll be with her today and heal her, Lord, and just take care of the issues that she has going on with balance and memory, and she's blind. So, Father, I just pray that you help her in all situations. Lord, we also want to pray for our churches. Father, they've suffered such a blow from this exile that we were in last year, Lord. We were exiled from our churches, Father, and just like many of the Israelites, they never found their way home. So, Father, I pray that people will find their way back to churches, Lord, back to you, back to worship you, Lord. Something that needs to happen. So, Father, I pray that you will open eyes, open doors, encourage people to come back to churches. Father, we also want to pray for safe travels for those that are at family camp, that they get home safely. Lord, we also want to pray for all of those who just seem to have lost their way, Lord. Pray that you will just reveal yourself to them, Lord. And let them know that you never leave. We're the ones that have the problem on leaving, not you. That you are always with us, Lord. Always with us. Father, we thank you. We love you. And most of all, we trust you. We trust in what you tell us is true. Father, we thank you. And we ask it all in your precious name. Amen. Let the whole church say, amen. First of all, in closing this morning, y'all do offering? Do an offering this morning? Okay, we're not doing offering. Okay, I'll continue. It's dangerous for my wife to be where I can see her, because she can derail me in a split second. I love my wife. But in closing this morning, first I want to say this to you. Thank y'all for letting me be here today and preach to y'all. It was awesome. Thank y'all for letting me do that. Scripture I want to read to us this morning in closing is in Numbers. May the Lord bless you. And the Lord make his face shine upon you. May it shine upon you, and his grace be with you. And the Lord lift you up, his countenance upon you, and give you peace. Thank you. You are dismissed.